So I'll just play it. It's made by AMTV, a fellow called Greene. What's his surname? Greenwave. Christopher Greene, and he's a independent journalist out of Arizona. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to play the soundtrack to the video, and here it comes.
Hey everybody, I'm Christopher Green. You're tuning in to AMTV, Alternative Media Television. It is, of course, October 7th, 2013. I wanted to give a brief but vigorous shout-out, enthusiastic shout-out, to Truckers for the Constitution and their plan to slow D.C. Beltway traffic and actively arrest congressmen committing treason against the United States Constitution. Again, let me repeat that. Truckers for the Constitution plan to slow D.C. Beltway traffic and arrest congressmen that have committed treason against the Constitution. You can see an image here. Truck drivers slowed down traffic on the highway on October 18, 2010 in France, where there was a similar protest held. Tractor-trailer drivers will intentionally clog the inner loop of the Washington, D.C. Beltway beginning on the morning of October 11th, which is a Friday, according to a coordinator of the upcoming Truckers Ride for the Constitution rally. So this occurs this Friday on October 11th. I've had several emails sent to me personally asking me to get the word out to help raise awareness for this very public protest, because the truckers are pissed off in this country. One of the main grievances that they cite are the United States, the President, Barack Obama, as well as congressmen that have supported the active army of Syrian rebels to overthrow the Bashar al-Assad government. They've cited that as an act of treason. They have cited anyone in Congress or anyone in government to support that, to be a traitor, and they're citing this for reasons and a reason for the arrest. Help us get this out. Help us make this heavily shared throughout the blogosphere. Conlin, one of the organizers of the event, says Obama committed treason by allegedly funneling weapons to al-Qaeda-linked rebels in Syria. Members of Congress who support arming Syrian rebels, he said, are accessories to the alleged crime. He identified House Minority Leader Nancy Pelosi, California, Senator Dianne Feinstein of California as politicians he will seek to arrest for alleged acts against the Constitution. Anders has said that they've had 3,000 truckers RSVP. They've now lost count of how many truckers and are attending the event and public protests, along with hundreds of emails a day that they can barely keep up with. Now, there is a Facebook page with almost 50,000 likes. Their original Facebook page was censored and taken down. I don't know if it was Facebook that took it down or pressure from the government, but please like this page, share this page, share this video with everyone you can. Please make it viral. Support our truckers, support the Constitution, support America. And you know what? Americans in Washington in general need to be concerned. The president needs to be concerned. I've read statistics that say that if our truckers stopped delivering necessary items like food to grocery stores, it would take about 2 days. That's 2 days before the store would run out and people wouldn't be able to eat. They wouldn't be able to go buy bottled water and everyday necessities. That's how quickly and how dependent we are on the trucking industry and on these truckers that are very obviously angry, some of which are calling for the impeachment of President Barack Obama and are actively seeking to arrest congressmen in Washington, D.C. on October 11th, this coming Friday in 2013. Please get this out everywhere. I'm Christopher Greene, hard-hitting and in-your-face. Make this video viral.
Dun, dun, dun. The viral video from Arizona. Guys, my guest tonight, two gentlemen who have contributed in various ways to the Journeys Project. And so I'd like to welcome on to tonight's show Jay Larson and Dave Kelso. Good evening, Jay.
Good evening, JP.
Good evening, Dave.
Good evening, Sean Connery. How are you doing? You've been quite the topic of chat conversation.
Have I really? Well, I missed it all, and I can't get it back on this thing. So, luckily, it was everybody's own. it was all your own joy. I won't be able to indulge in that anyway.
And my friend Michelle is also listening. She's on Nudable Spirit Radio and all of this and the whole, you know, internet radio scene, I guess you could say. I'm sure she's just digging your accent right now, so why don't you give a shout out to Michelle. All right, Mr. Connery, go ahead.
Oh, well, actually, I have to say that Mr. Connery is, in fact, a Scotsman. And I'm not a Scotsman. I live in Scotland. He has got that nice little accent when he it's a contraction in the throat. Every British accent is various contractions in different parts of the head. A lot of it is tension at the back of the mouth. But he's got this delightful little lisp when he speaks. So anyway, meanwhile, a big shout out to Rochelle there in the Wall Street chat room. Here we are. We're talking about some serious stuff here, guys, and brothers and sisters all over the blue planet that we're spinning around on the surface of. I actually have a tiny creature in my room. I talk about these fellows all the time. From June till about mid-October, they exist, the midges, and they just exist to annoy you. And for many, many months, I've been very vegan about them and not tried to kill any. But
a little creature in your room. I didn't know you invited Henry Kissinger over.
Well,
an annoying little creature, you know.
We all know about Henry and his clones. So where do we start? Dave, you posted the video this morning, and
yeah, Jay actually brought it to my attention, so I think I'll let Jay start off with his perspective, because, you know, him and I were talking about it before the show, and there was a bunch of things he was saying about it, so I talk too much all the time anyway, so this gives me an opportunity to shut the hell up and let someone else do the talking for a change. So take it away, Jay.
I go around on Facebook. I use it much like a newspaper to get the basic news, because your regular media doesn't cover the real news. But I take everything with basically a grain of salt. It's just data. And the more data you have where certain things seem to connect, the more accurate it probably is. On this one, a lot of it is more of a let's see what happens type of thing. You know, it could be people just trying to bring up certain attentions that Congress hasn't been acting or behaving very well, and they're going to put an end to it. Now, this can be done just by creating a video. It doesn't mean they have to actually do anything besides that. If the Congress gets a hold of it, they might start straightening the hind end up and start voting the people's choice instead of making money from this corporatism that usually supports them in their reelection. They can start supporting the citizens that have been voted them in to basically do the will of the people. So personally, I keep it at, basically, I give it a chance of happening, 1-to-1. It may happen that way, it may not. But we do definitely know that these truckers are ticked off, and we know that they're going to be in Washington in a few days. They could do anything from just parking their vehicle on the beltway and, you know, practically seal the city off to opening up the national parks and national monuments that have been closed the last few days because of government shutdown. So it's an open event. In the last hour and a half, we've been trying to get a hold of this Christopher Greene, and we left messages. We haven't got a call back yet, but I noticed that he has that Greenwave radio show tomorrow night. I don't know the exact time, but it might be worth listening to that show. They may impart a little bit more information. Either way, what would you say about that, Dave?
Well, I'd say you make some very good points. I mean, you know, like, on one point, obviously, I personally would, you know, love it if, like, you know, 500,000 frickin' truckers just kind of peacefully stormed in and, you know, just made their, you know, citizens' arrests and, you know, the police, you know, at that point had better either be on board or get out of their way. And I see no reason why that sort of thing couldn't be done, you know, completely peacefully. I mean, I don't see why it would have to resort to, you know, violence or anything else. I think it could all be, you know, a very peaceful process and, you know, drag these people into, you know, a court or whatever and, you know, proceed from there and start to rein this corrupt government in. On the other hand, you know, it's like I try to be as objective as I can possibly be, and I definitely see a possibility here that I definitely can't deny, that, you know, how the elites always love to play their little silly games with us and their false flags and their psychological warfares and, you know, misdirect us, and they laugh as we're their chattel, and they can push and they can prod, and, you know, we jump when they say jump. Well, somebody out there might be trying to start a precedent to where, you know, it gets proven that, you know, we could do the same thing, that all we have to do is make a profound enough statement and put out a when we say jump and get them nervous and kind of like, you know, turn about a spare play and payback's a bitch. So even if it's not going to be a literal arrest, it might set a precedent for, you know, pretty much everybody, just open season on minds growing the Illuminati, basically. Where, you know, everybody will start bombarding the elites with their own, you know, little mind games, and maybe we'll dish them back what they've been dishing out to us. So maybe there is not going to be any physical arrest. Maybe the truck will just go through, and the truckers will be like Nelson sitting there on The Simpsons going, ha, suckers, and that'll set a precedent for everybody to just, you know, start screwing with them, and maybe they'll end up all resigning out of just pure, like, you know, post-traumatic freaking stress disorder, because everyone's constantly shooting all this, you know, disinfo their way. Not disinfo to misdirect the people, but, you know, to put the elites on edge, you know, turn about a spare play. But then again, it could be actual arrests. I mean, I have to look at all these possibilities objectively. I personally don't care which happens. I mean, whether they actually drag them out and arrest them, or whether we psychologically warfare them into resigning, or, you know, whatever the case is, I mean, I don't really care. I'm not, you know, biased for or against any particular methods, as long as, you know, the people are developing,
methods to where we're not just sitting there expecting our selected misleaders to, you know, do everything for us, and as adulthood becomes a state of extended adolescence, and that, you know, people are actually using discernment and critical thinking and their imagination and creativity and starting to swing this holographic illusion of so-called physical reality more into the direction of sovereignty. So whatever way we, you know, we can get more and more there, you know, to that point, I mean, I'm all for it. And anything that can be done peacefully and nonviolently, I'm all for it. Because they don't know how to handle nonviolence. Now, if you're violent, they know exactly what to do with you. But if you can handle this through intelligence and through strategy and through psychology, then, you know, rather than, you know, totally open violence, they'd love nothing more than a bloody civil war or revolution or whatever. It gives them an excuse to get out all their toys and, you know, confound and confuse everybody and send everybody packing against each other. But if we can do everything calmly, then that'd be great. I'd also like to recommend a video by, there's a channel called Storm Clouds Gathering, or was it Rising? I'm pretty sure it's Gathering. The title of the video, I think, is Revolution, an Instruction Manual or an Instruction Guide or something like that. Anyway, the person does have a very efficient, packed way in a short video, just explains the whole consciousness revolution and how that can be practically applied to this, you know, 3D left brain reality, and in such a way that doesn't result in this, you know, violent death.
That, well, this is the entire nub of it. You know, the revolution isn't a bunch of people with weapons. We're way beyond that. The revolution is internal, and people might not even notice it if they didn't know what to look for. And the revolution is not being televised, but people are uploading it to the YouTube. And actually, you know, many years ago, we used to do this, I used to do a jam session. I used to come up with these sort of little raps and stuff like that. But, you know, based on the Gil Scott Heron thing, the revolution will not be televised. As we're seeing, you know, it is not being televised yet. I think I must have said it about 2002, said that the revolution won't be televised, it will be uploaded to YouTube. I didn't realize that by then people would have telephones actually directly send information straight into YouTube from their hands. So, you know, more than televised, it will be seen by a million eyes, through a million eyes. So and what has to happen first is a revolution of consciousness, because, as you say, this holographic projection that we find ourselves existing in, it's like asking a goldfish, you know, how's the water? It's like, well, yeah, well, what's water?
Yeah.
So,
what's the water stuff you're talking about?
Exactly. You know, what's the difference? What's air? You know, but so the thing is that we have to get beyond the point of thinking that the government is here to do anything but slow us down and control us. And, you know, then we get to the real, you know, what happens after the revolution? Do we have more of the same? Do we have something that is imposed on us that is worse than the same? Or do we throw away all the same old stuff and start actually working with systems that are organic and follow the laws of nature? And what I mean by that is...
Yeah, that's what that guy says.
Well,
in the video and book. He actually goes, he addresses exactly what you just said, and he has some very good answers to those.
Who's that?
Storm Clouds Gathering, that one, Revolution, handbook guy. Let me just see if I can find this real quick, and I'll toss the link into the chat room.
Okay, good idea. I'll put them into Rev Radio and to Wolf Spirit Radio's chat.
as well. Actually, you could do that. You could do the chat as well.
I'm evil spirit chat. You can put it the other way.
Okay. It's the revolution of consciousness and the revolution of mind, understanding the nature of who we are and what we are, and what we're actually working with. You know, we're not working against terrorists. We're working against the corporation. You know, the war, the people are not your enemy. The corporation, let's not say it's our enemy. Let's say it's our predator. You know, we just want to not be eaten.
You know, I got an even better one. Corporations are just tools, and there's people that are running these tools. So, I mean, think of it like fire. Fire's neither good nor evil. You can cook your food with it, or, you know, you can burn the crap out of yourself with it. Mm. So when we allow corporations to become too big and out of control and running our lives, and it's like, you know, the forest fire, not the little burner on the stove that's you know, cooking up your hard-boiled eggs or whatever, you know. So we the people need to realize that we have allowed these things to, you know, get out of hand, because, you know, the educational system, which literally is based on neo-Nazism, by the way, people can look that one up, but basically it narrows our minds so that we don't see the obvious hiding in plain sight. I mean, because everything is admitted out in the open. I mean, hell, even look at the word governmental. Governmental, mind control, and it translates the exact same in Latin too.
Well, yeah, a governor is a little device that you have on an engine that stops it overrunning, overspinning. So it's there to put a cap on things, to slow things down if they expand too much, because the government doesn't want the people's consciousness to expand too much, just enough so that they can operate the machines, but not so much that they realize that, hang on, there's only 10 of them and like 2 million of us. You know, that kind of, well, it's actually a much more enormous proportion than that. And
oh yeah, I did a video on that one, by the way.
Yeah, I've seen that little dot one. That's very good. There's a lot more to realize about the whole situation, because we're thinking, you know, it's the government and we need a government. And and here's another one. We elect a government. You know, that's a joke. That's the biggest joke. You know, that's the biggest joke of the 21st century. I don't think there's been a real election for, well, in this century,
kidding.
Really.
as a matter of fact, people only need a government who are unable to think critically and use discernment. But when you teach everybody...
Sorry, Dave. Sorry, I just really have to take this up. We don't need a government. We are very good at governing ourselves.
My point is that government's babysitters, and we're tricked into adulthood being a state of extended adolescence. If you allow me to clarify my context, I'm not in any way, shape, or form advocating government. I'm saying that we've been tricked into thinking that we have to be narrow-minded idiots, and we don't, because only narrow-minded idiots need to be governed. So we've been tricked into repressing the fullness of ourselves and tricked into thinking we're just poor little me. We're not taught critical thinking or discernment in school. We've been narrow-minded. And all we have to do is realize that we can expand our mind and then start to do that, and then we don't need babysitters, because only babies need babysitters. So all I have to do is stop being babies, because only babies can be subject to the mind games. Once you've grown up, guess what? You don't fall for the BS anymore. That's my point.
So, the revolution of the mind, instead of revolvement, because we, you know, the governing of the mind, we need to remove the governing. We don't need governing. We just need administration. You know, it's all in the words. You know, administration means, you know, that's just ministering, serving the need. As opposed to a janitor. Control. Yeah, the government is a janitor. The president is the chief janitor. It's in service. That's what we've been led to believe. However, we've been in this thing for thousands of years,
these systems have grown up from these places. You know, they were in Ur in Babylon, and they were in Rome, and then they were in Egypt, and, you know, and then were in Greece. You know, they had these systems, and they imposed them on the people. And finally, they've got one that can just about cover the whole skin of the planet. But it's really ropey. And it relies on a massive amount of fear sticking to us. And it's like, this is the worst time to try and get stuff to stick to us, because we're being roasted by solar activity.
Yeah. You know? That's why word magic has been instrumental in the deception, because, you know, what the idea, the basic idea, or shall we say the propaganda as to what we're told government is, but it isn't, as far as being a janitorial service that is supposed to be in service. Word magic has been used to twist the definitions of words and context so much, and the reason we're able to fall for this little trap is because we've been made to think that the tools are our masters instead of we being the master wielders of the tools. Like, how many people say, you know, yes, my career profession is computer technician. How many people own that like that? Nobody. They say, I am a computer technician. I fit in the societally defined and labeled box of computer technician. I have to conform myself to it. I am a gender. I am an age. I am a career profession. I am this. No, you're not any of these things. You possess these things, like you own a shirt, you own pants, you own the chair you're sitting in, you own your furniture, you have possessions. These things are yours, but they don't own you. And we've been tricked into thinking that these things own us. So we try to conform to the ideal of what that is, as if it's a box we have to stuff ourselves into. And he who controls, or she in some cases, who controls the label and the definition controls all who believe in it. So we become slaves to the tools, and that's how they've caught us in the trap. That's just my perspective.
So, slaves to the tool.
Obama is a tool, by the way. He's a major tool.
Apparently there's a there's a mole in a certain position. But anyway, according to my informants. But talking of tools and talking of the mind, this is where I'm really going to, is to bring in another level of this. Now, these guys are using energies that are generated from the worst of human behavior, of murder and, you know, putting into fierce states of fear, and they use that energy. It's like Monsters, Inc. But there is plenty of natural free energy that doesn't have that same karma attached to it. And this is where I'm getting to, because this is your field, Jay Larson. So the revolution will not be televised. The revolution will be internal. Where do people look inside of themselves, and how can scalar technology help?
Well, basically, scalar technology is basically quantum technology. That's where, to put it bluntly, it's basic understanding that we don't live in a time matrix. It's all an illusion, because everything is in quantum superposition, and it's what we believe is what actually happens. So basically, when we observe something, it actually condenses down and becomes solid. There's nothing really solid there to begin with.
Also, refer to the double slit experiment in the documentary What the Bleep Do We Know?
me.
Yeah, well, it's all a quantum illusion that we think that there's time to begin with, and basically that's all they've done is program us on what we should see. You know, and once you decide, well, hey, this is an illusion and it's not real, that I can have, if I really concentrate on it, I can have anything I want because it's all an illusion and everything's in superposition.
And all the things I have done also shall you do, and greater still than these shall you do. Jesus Christ, mm-hmm. The book of John.
So, that's stopped the conversation a bit. Meanwhile, back in scalar technology, and scalar waves are generated by creating electromagnetic waves and subtraction through the configuration of the coil. The shape of the coil, what it does, the way the coil is wound, it cancels one half of the wave out, leaving the other half. Now, as is my wont, and I always remember, I always forget the right way round, where there's two of things, you know, if it's left, if it's right, you know, I've got this thing. And so, I can never remember which one is yin and which one is yang. I mean, really, really stupid stuff like that. And Stillings is always saying about oscillating doses. So, a scalar wave, Jay Larson, is a electric-only wave or a magnetic-only wave?
It's both. You can have both. What it is that you're having both polarities being played out simultaneously. In other words, you're having things happening in an instant. Everything is happening together at the same time. That's what a scalar wave is.
Everything's happening at the same time.
Right. In other words, you got a negative charge, but you got an equal and opposite positive charge that is being generated at the same time. And occupying the same space. And you don't have time constraints on the energy. The energy moves at superluminal velocities, which is a fancy way of saying that it's running faster than the speed of light.
So presumably it's held to the speed of light because light has a magnetic component. And this one has less of a magnetic component.
Mm-hmm.
So it's more slippery, less sticky.
Well, actually, the only thing that travels at the speed of light is light. You can basically travel over the speed of light as a solid matter. You could travel over the speed of light or under the speed of light, but you can't travel the speed of light. Or you'd just be an electromagnetic wave.
So, turning ourselves into an electromagnetic wave and becoming light enables us to travel. However, that's a little different from the topic of where we're going with this, although it does tie in that what we're talking about is, again, that we live in this holographic universe. It's we're in a program somewhere and we're kind of stuck in the corner and we don't realize that there is an exit door. And the exit door is that which we have been programmed to not look at, you know, whether it be evil or terrorists or this or that. This is the direction we need to be looking in. And the reason is because we need to be held in fear, because that holds us into the trap. The fear of, well, it's like the monkey trap. Do you know the monkey trap, Dave?
It's where there's a jar with something valuable in it that the monkey wants.
That's right. They use a coconut, you can put it in a jar. And the monkey grabs puts his hand in the jar and grabs the nuts and then tries to pull the fist out. But because the fist is bigger than the hand going in, the fist won't come out of the jar. And so the monkey's brain is tied between letting go of the precious gift.
Here, yeah, my little precious.
Or, or holding on to the prize, which traps him. That's the monkey trap. And so basically it's, we need to think, when we need to think beyond monkey mind, we need to think beyond that linear. I have to hold on to this because this is precious. This is what's killing us. This is what holds us in the trap. And that is money and government and the idea that we're protected by the government and all of this BS.
And our sacred cows and the twistings of religion and what is supposedly polite and supposedly impolite and supposedly appropriate and supposedly inappropriate and all that goes completely against individuality and totally endorses fascism and totalitarianism. Well, we're in denial of the fact that we're supporting fascism and totalitarianism, and we're taught to defend our own individuality while simultaneously seeing everybody else's individuality as an attack. So then we're taught that we can't relate to each other and blah, 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 blah. And so we have, you know, the battle of the sexes, the battle of the religions, the battle of this, the battle of that. Oh, that person's polite and that person's rude and this person's this and this person's that. No, that person likes that TV show, so they suck and I don't want to deal with them, or blah, 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 blah. There's all these mechanisms of division. Monkey trap.
So, Jay, how do we encourage people to rise above their immediate greed and need and get them to open their fist and take their hand out of the monkey trap? How do we figuratively work that one out?
Well, the easiest way, first of all, that you are just yourself, and basically what we're doing is learning how to be ourselves. And the easiest way to be yourself is by doing things for yourself. You basically do things that you enjoy doing. And basically what that does, it changes your focus. First of all, it's keeping your vibration at a more optimal, higher frequency level, and it allows you to explore things that you wouldn't normally explore. And by doing so, you'll naturally evolve and become more yourself. And then you begin getting whispers or intuition that increases you becoming more yourself. And it's just a gradual, natural process. You don't really have to work at it. All you got to do is basically do things that you like to do, express what you like, and it's like being a child again and just going out and playing and having a good time. It'll cause you to focus on having joy instead of worrying about things that you don't even really need to worry about.
I agree. As a matter of fact, David Icke has a really good analogy for exactly what's going on. Because we, as little children, we're born being able to be ourselves and know all this and do all this. So we need all this time and money and resources and all this put into this so-called educational system, which is nothing more than Nazi propaganda and internment camp. And these mechanisms which hold us down, he says, to imagine a fish tank, like, you know, a standard, like, 10-gallon tank or whatever, and it's filled up with water. And there's a ping-pong ball, and it's floating on the top of the water. Well, imagine if you take your hand and push that ping-pong ball down to the bottom of the tank, that is the hand of the totalitarian state. Our natural automatic state is to be ourselves, naturally, and be in that knowing, and be in that wisdom, and be in that intelligence. And if the totalitarian state lifts up its hand, even for just a moment, that ping pong ball will rise all the way back up to the surface. So being ourselves is more of a matter of allowing, because
we've been trained to build up all these emotional and psychological and core belief system walls around ourselves, which are the hand that keeps the ping pong ball down. Everybody thinks they have to go out and get something that they don't have to somehow learn how to be who they're supposed to be, and they're not realizing that, you know, everything is happening automatically. Who you are is trying to happen automatically. The universe functions automatically. Kind of like you don't have to turn a crank to keep your heart pumping. It just, you know, it just does. So it's all a matter of learning how to tear down the walls that we've been trained to put up, so that automatic us being ourselves thing that just automatically happens can just be allowed in, you know, break down the dam and let the water flow.
So, how do we, I mean, basically, it's not really about breaking things. It's more about, I think, dissolving things so that things become integrated. That's what a solution is, isn't it? When you have a liquid and a solid, and you add the liquid to the solid, then the solid dissolves and becomes a solution.
But it's all language semantics again, because one context of a breakdown, a dissolving of a solution, is a breakdown of one thing into another. So there's truth being colored by perspective once again. The easiest way to do that dissolving that I've learned, really the only way to do that dissolving, is at your own pace and in your own way. Allow yourself that, you know, enjoyment of the journey rather than being in a mad rush to the destination. Because we're taught to be neurotic and think that, you know, if we can't plant a tree seed today and have a 40-foot tree tomorrow, that we've done something wrong, we've done something naughty. We have all these unreasonable expectations of ourselves, and we think that somebody else's pace, somebody else's way is the right way. But really, our own pace and our own way, that self-exploration, and all of it, and just enjoying the environment around us, metaphorically speaking, that non-rushing, that observing what is for what is, and taking things at our own pace, is the way to do that. And to understand that people will operate this at different paces, and if someone can operate at a faster pace than you, that doesn't mean they're doing something more right than you, or that you're doing something wrong, or they're better than you, because your pace will pick up as you develop the neural networks to, you know, support what you're looking to do. Biology is automatically what it is. Neurology is what it is, and as you practice, you will develop more neural networks to make things easier on yourself, just like how a baby doesn't go to school to learn how to walk. It's just kind of a process over time. It learns how to crawl, then walk, then run, so on and so forth. So, you know, it's one of the big things to realize is just whatever your pace is, it's okay, and to not compare yourself to other people. Because within this awakening process, you ever notice that everyone's always trying to compare their pace to someone else? Like, oh, they're so much farther ahead. They must be doing something right that I'm not doing. I must be doing something wrong. I'm not evolving fast enough. I'm not ascending into 5G fast enough, or whatever silly expectations they put on themselves. They're comparing themselves to everybody else and beating themselves up. It's like, no, everybody's got their own path, their own way, their own it's all good. Allow them to be themselves. That's individuality. Allow you to be yourself. That's individuality. If someone else's pace is faster or slower or different or whatever, it's good. It's cool. It's diversity. It's mixing it up. It's, you know, the universe loves diversity and limitless potentiality. You know, it's good. It's not a bad thing. Just roll with it and allow you to be you. You don't need to be the fire. Just be the spark that gets the fire going, and just, you know, flow. Don't fight the current.
You can't push a river, but you can make it a different flavor. Jay, how do we influence the flow factor of the time stream?
because I really did believe it's been messed with by all these harps and their Tesla technology that they've had for a long time, messing our heads, and, you know, whoever else's technology has been messing around with our heads. How do we, as people, you know, these devices that you're making, they're really simple, aren't they? They're, you know, it's easy to find a design for a Caduceus coil. You whack it into an MP3 player and boom, you've got a scalar device. What other tools are available to the people for making the flow fizzier and happier to be in? Jay? Have we lost Jay?
Muted. Okay, first of all, I'd like to say, generally, the best technology is always the inner technology, because it's flexing. Usually what we'll do, we'll conceive of an idea and we'll make it outside ourselves first and have the tool, but that tool reflects what we can do with internally and we don't need it. But usually what we use an external tool for is to basically get a concept of what's going on. It's easier to sort out things like what time is and what parallel dimensions are when you build a technology that helps you to sort of pierce into them. But it all comes down really to awareness, because we're jumping into parallel universes all the time, and we don't even realize it, because there's always a variance of time and things happening on an individual level as well as a collective level. Basically what you call say manifesting something is basically doing that. You create an alignment to your emotions and your intent, and you're just jumping basically to a timeline that will synchronize that object to appears as a synchronistic event. So we do it all the time. Now we learn to build certain machines, now like the scalar devices. By themselves, we're just using one aspect of it, using an alternating scalar wave of different frequencies, just basically experimenting to find out what they'll do. But there's other factors that come in where you can actually create a scalar wave that is nothing more than a what you would call a direct current pulse. And all of a sudden, what does that direct current pulse do? It acts like a sail, and you can actually ride on a similar scalar wave that's more of an alternating wave, because you'll only go in one direction because you're pulsing in one direction. So it acts, the main scalar wave acts like a wind, and your little pulse scalar wave acts much like a sail, and so the wind pushes you along. And you use that basically both for time travel and also transporting yourself from one point to another point, much like UFOs. It's just that they're just using a more advanced type of sailing than we used back in the 1600s and 1700s. Some catch the wave, and the wave then pushes you along. And that's what we're starting to learn with that, some of the effects of these scalar waves. And it's mostly an experiment.
So on the air, are you still with us? Are you still with us? I lost you.
Yeah, I think I've got probably lost everybody. In that case, I'm going to call back. Yes, we're back on the air. Sorry, welcome back there. Something happened to our Skype. This call got completely mangled. While that was happening, I just got this in, and so far we've got 3,000 truckers are planning to descend on Washington D.C. on the 11th to protest the NDAA's indefinite detention without trial provision, as well as to raise awareness of what they perceive as continued Obama administration support for radical Islamic factions in Egypt and Syria. Despite the near mainstream, my microphone. Dave Kelso, are you with us still?
I am now. Oh, I called back in.
Well,
wow. The whole thing had dropped me off. I posted it in the chat room.
Okay.
Looking there.
Welcome to Jenny's.
Apparently people are perusing my DeviantArt gallery and posting my link.
People who might want to follow this up.
So chubby.
Yeah, yeah. It could be Solar Flare.
Can you hear me? I'm hearing nothing.
I can hear you guys perfectly.
Okay.
1, 2, 3.
Okay, we're back now.
Yeah, we're getting dropped. Randomly at different places. I hope that I'm still on the air, and we're working towards it. I'm going to be, we're going to be taking a break in a few minutes, and so we'll try and recreate the call as we do this. But there does seem to be some issue with the internet, as there was a little bit last night. Was it around that time? Well, no, it was much earlier in the evening. So we'll see how we do, and hopefully we'll make it to the end of the hour, and then down to the next hour. We'll be discussing more things. I'd like, if anybody would like to come in and give their take on what people could do in their time. You're contracting 3,000 people, you know, 30 million of you. What else can you do?
Okay. We're having some serious dysfunctions. I keep getting nailed off.
Mm.
Not offline or anything, but off of this call.
Off this call. Oh, I know. It's very weird. Anyway, I'll call you back in a couple of minutes. Here comes the break. Don't go away. We'll still be back.
Yes, it's Journeys with JP. Tonight, it's 9 p.m. Eastern Time. Atlantic Time. And, what is it? 6 p.m. Pacific time. We're talking about a trucker's march. Not really a march, trucker's convoy. what do truckers do when they get together? You know, it's like, is there a collective noun for truckers? Yeah. So, like a murder of crows and a school of fish. So, my guests tonight are Jay Larson and Dave Kelso. So, who wants to jump in with the next fragment of this this large topic?
Yeah, it's amazing that all these things are happening as the powers that were are starting to lose their money, and they're running out of money, basically, and they're putting stops on the government and punishing the people by these foolish acts, what they're doing with the national parks. So they're just waking up all kinds of people, and we're going to make it happen much, much quicker. Because, when they put the screws to us, people wake up. You know, you start to wake up out of the dream state that they have us in, because, you know, they're trying to be, use punitive things. They're trying to use these misdirections and false flags and everything, and it's starting to backfire on them big time. And now the people are, by the way, the they've been behaving since the, you know, the shutdown of our government. They're based all these punitive acts against the people and the states. The states are starting to rebel from the federal government and decided to take their own course. And the people are waking up as well. And now with this Tucker thing, we're going to help bring a lot of it, so to speak, to a head. You know, we're going to throw the ball back in their court and we'll go see what happens.
So, using scalar technology, we're not actually, it's, like I said, we're not using the intent to cause harm to anybody. In fact, it's quite the opposite. It's the intention to make everybody happy, which is our natural state of being. It's like the ping pong ball at the top of the, floating on the top of the thing, of the water, you know, we're that light. So it's really, it kind of, in, you know, like going back to that, that same, analogy is we're dissolving the hand that is holding us down, allowing us to float up, hey Dave? Jay.
Oh, definitely. First of all, we're getting to a point we've had enough and we decide not to be in fear and loathing anymore. We decided to have enough, so we're taking responsibility for things that are happening, so we decide to make changes. And that's why things are happening now, because everyone started to make changes, because they're tired of government. They're tired of all the lies and deception. In fact, government is actually helping us. They don't realize when the NSA monitors everyone in the world that the Illuminati are being monitored by them too. So what happens when government falls? And we get all those records and we can find out who criminally did this and did that. And we'll just put them away where they won't cause any more harm. You know, they're producing the structures for their own end and they don't even realize by their fear of not, got to know what everything we're doing, they put, they're included as well, so they're supplying us basically with the evidence because their phones are being tapped like everyone else's. Their emails are being read. So, their whereabouts are being watched by the same satellites as everyone else. So they're supplying the means to their own end.
Well, as long as we are on internet radio, and as long as we're having more than just a little bit of fun at the expense of the Illuminati, I am going to give you something in just a moment, JP, that is rather short, and we're just going to have a little bit of fun with it, poking some fun at the Illuminati here. Now, where in the heck did this go? It's a little parody thing I made a while ago called A Special Message from the RIAA. I think we all know who the RIAA is, right?
No.
The recording industry assholes, I mean Association of America, the multinational corporation pretending not to be.
Oh, the copyright claimers. Oh, they're part of the Vatican. Yeah, anyway.
Yeah, the copyright Nazis. Needless to say, I am about to slip you a link for an audio, it's very short, and I would just like to like for you to play that right quick, seeing as when you play things through, it actually sounds better than if I were to do it. And then I'll provide the link in the chat room afterwards. It's real short. It's like spoofing like one of those like short little radio blurb public service announcement things, but this is just making fun of the RIAA, and there it is. And Americans especially will be able to relate.
Oh, okay. Awesome.
LegalMusicSearch.com.
This is a public service message from the Recording Industry Assholes of America, a greedy multinational corporation. When you illegally download MP3s off the interweb, you are committing copyright infringement, which is against the law. We will find you, you criminal scum. We will have our way with your 12-year-old daughters. We'll play intern with your college student. We will break your disabled uncle's legs off. We will skull fuck your elderly grandmother. And as for your deceased great-grandfather, well, does the term necrophilia ring any bells for you? Yeah. And if you're really bad, we may even rape your dog and send you to the Amish. Just think about it, folks. The Amish. No phones. No cars. No lights, and certainly no computers. You won't be doing much illegal downloading then, will you, you criminal scum? So just remember, folks, give us all your money, even though we charge too much. Or our inflated music prices, yes. And do not illegally download from the interwebs, because we will hunt you down and kill you. This has been a public service message from the Recording Industry Assholes of America.
Well, I'm not sure if everybody...
No, that major distortion, there was...
Something was coming over the revolution line as if somebody was else... on the line, is anybody dialed into the Studio B thing who shouldn't be? I should only have three people here.
Or did Jay forget to mute his microphone and maybe it was causing a feedback loop or something?
No, it wasn't feedback looping for me. I had my mic muted at the time.
Well, anyway, Dave, if you post that into the chat room in Wall
Street. Yeah, that would probably be best. Weird. I mean, your original playback with the trucker thing like came out like clear as a bell.
Yeah, but it just seems something's happening at the studio level. It's like there's a speaker on the microphone or something like that. I don't know why, because it shouldn't be happening, but it is.
Well, either timeline and frequency shifts are screwing with technology, as sometimes can happen, or the powers who assume they be do not particularly appreciate our particular brand of humor and are expressing their concerns.
I turned my scalar wave off. I had the 200 megahertz scalar wave on, and it may be causing... differences in frequency that could be interfering with the...
is appreciated. We all do this for absolutely nothing. We put in loads of content per week. Dave is schlepping his kishkas out to deliver to you a high-quality audio radio system. And we have plenty of hosts and plenty of new and ancient information that is being blended for you... so to speak, to and juice. We blend all that old gritty stuff, juice it and bring it back to you, make it interesting sounding, adding personal stories and proceeding with the personal, psychic, and spiritual evolution of humanity.
Yep, and you know, JP, we mustn't forget that on WolfSpiritRadio.com, unlimited access to the archives is only $5 a month.
Only $5 a month will give you some of the best programming material that you're likely, well, in fact, deprogramming material that is likely to
As a matter of fact, hopefully y'all have a really, really good fast internet connection and a huge hard drive, because there is so much of it, your brain will just implode in a cosmic orgasm of consciousness when you just see how many terabytes of files that actually know, not porn, radio archives. Just how much is there?
Yeah, it's how can we put this? It's a sort of it's like the opposite of pornography, because pornography draws you in, and this kind of is like, how much more of this can I take? but at the same time, it's food for a very special part of us that has been starved for a very, very long time. And I just am so stoked and unbelievably happy to be part of the movement that is bringing this information out to the people. The other thing is that we haven't been killed yet.
It's a good thing. I mean, I always kind of refer to these sorts of things as kind of taking a form of spiritual fiber con, because I refer to paradigm shifting as paradigm shifting, and I've made several humorous graphics to that effect and so on and so forth, because when you're in one mode of consciousness and then you shift to another, I mean, for all of you who are in the chat room, and if Rochelle hasn't nodded off yet, she can also attest to conversations that her and I have had, to where just one little tiny piece of information just like leads to a domino effect, just this explosion, this expansion of consciousness. It's just, it's freaking amazing. The tiniest little piece of knowledge can change everything you know. Like, how much, like, the knowledge that the Earth isn't flat, you know, that has inspired so much technology. I mean, 95% of what we know as, you know, just normal everyday technology and knowledge wouldn't even have ever been invented if we all thought that the world was still flat and there's an edge of the Earth to fall off of. So if one little tiny piece of technology, or excuse me, one tiny piece of information can profoundly change everything you ever thought you knew and your perspectives on everything, what do people think that gigs and gigs and gigs and gigs and gigs and gigs of archives from the Little Spirit Radio Archives are going to do? Take it slow. You don't want your brain to shatter, because it might.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's interesting. I was just listening to the show that I did with Rob Potter and Cobra the other day, and one thing stuck out from me from what he said, which was, you just got to do what you do. You can't, I mean, whatever it is you like doing, do that, and I understand that, because that gives you, it's driven by love, it's not driven by fear. You know, if you think, oh, I've got to go out and earn money because I've got a massive mortgage and I've got the kids and I don't want to let everybody down and all these other things, then you're going to, you know, it's going to put you in a position that you hate doing. And that's the way of the world. And this is part of that hatred, that kind of, that helps to oil the wheels of industry on a black magical level. Because it's basically, you know, that fear and hatred is used as a fuel. Much as Monsters, Inc. did with the children's fear.
And a neat thing about these talks and stuff, they set fire to your imagination, and you're only limited to what you can imagine.
Well,
that is true. I often tell people that people try to like struggle and turn a crank to get their imagination to work, and people don't realize imagination operates on its own. It's something to be observed. let it do its thing, kind of like you let your heart beat. Let imagination flow through you. Don't try to grab it by the neck and choke it. There's no neck to grab. You'll just be fighting with shadows. Let your observe your imagination. It's a right brain thing, not a left brain thing. When people try to calculate their imagination, they're calculating nothing based on nothing, based on assumption, based on bullshit, based on nothing. They're not getting anywhere. Just let go. The imagination works on its own. Just observe it. Allow for those limitless potentials. Allow for that expansion to happen automatically. You don't have to turn a crank.
Well, like you said, it's just that, like the ping pong ball analogy. It's just our natural state of being is independent and sovereign and essentially free to be who we are. And it's really, I think I see the way of the future is a kind of combination of Native American family structures and attitudes towards the land. I think that it's very important that we have that kind of attitude, because it does preserve the land many, many thousands and thousands of years longer than we've managed. You know, America was kept beautiful, pristine, buffalo fields, all this stuff, sweet corn, you know, in 400 years, these white Khazarians have come over and wrecked the place. So I think, we need to certainly apply a lot of the caretaking of the planet back to the attitude of the traditional folk.
You know, that reminds me. There's a lot of people that dive into fear by blaming technology for what's happened, when technology is really just a tool. Our technology has come from the earth, and it's really no different than a beehive or a termite mound, just on a higher level. I mean, we've taken things from the earth and we've used them, and there are uses and there are misuses. And, you know, I remember back a long time ago in the Journeys with Rebecca chat room. I don't know if you remember this. I know you were there at the time for this conversation. There's this person insisting that if all technology were, you know, eradicated, that, you know, the world would be at peace and that technology was the cause of all our problems. It's like, look, they didn't have video games in the Middle Ages. They did very well slaughtering each other on horseback with swords. You know, technology is not this evil thing. With advanced technology, we could make technology that's in harmony with nature. I mean, you know, look what Tesla did. His technology wasn't in opposition to nature. It was in harmony with nature. And then J.P. Morgan shut him down, and the Illuminati stole the technology, and they've misused it and created things like HARP and whatever else. But, that, you know, that's been our own choice to misuse it. Technology inherently is just a tool. It's neutral. Like, fire is neither good nor evil. It just is. Gunpowder is neither good nor evil. You can make pretty fireworks with it, or you can blow people up with it. That's not the fault of the gunpowder. That's stupid humans doing stupid things. But, you know, let's stop blaming the tools, because that's how we give our power away. We blame the tools. Let's take responsibility. Let's stop passing the buck.
So this has like been my whole career, is working with technology. You know, I couldn't actually do what I do now. I couldn't have done that 7 years ago, 5 years ago. We didn't have PHP, you know, we didn't have all that stuff. Well, we did, but it was in very much in infancy. And now it's grown up and matured, and we've got more and more, technologies that take us into smaller and smaller things. You know, people are walking around with tiny little screens, you know. I can't even see. Well, maybe one day they'll create a pair of glasses for me that'll respond to my eyes. Wouldn't that be cool? Instead of having Google glasses where you can spy on people, how about having a pair of personal magnifying lenses so that you could zoom into things? You know, you want to read a car number plate, you kind of, you know, the way you look at the wheel, it'll pick up the way where your eyes are, and it will actually zoom in according to your intent. How cool would that be? That would be cool.
And it would also
adjust for, you know, reading up close. It wouldn't be a bifocal, it would just focus. Like an extra pair of eyes. Enhanced lenses.
Your eyes used to do that as a kid. Where the lettering just magnified itself while you weren't larger than normal sight. Our eyes have that capability already. We've just sort of lost it over the years, considering most of us are reading from a computer terminal, not from a book. But back when we did a lot of book readings, our eyes had the ability to magnify the letters, and as we grow older, we kind of forget those things. But
you know what I find ironically amusing?
What's that?
People typing volumes and volumes condemning technology while using a computer on the internet to condemn technology. That's like the ultimate irony of amusing hypocrisy. Oh, and speaking of technology and dealing with esoterics and stuff, one thing that people can do a search for on YouTube, a person by the name of Josh Reeves did a reading of the Book of Enki, and like the whole Book of Enki, like freaking reads like Star Trek. It's freaking hilarious. And of course, the way Josh Reeves reads it, he's just got this politically incorrect sense of humor, and he's just cracking jokes about the whole thing, and it really expands the mind, and it's funny. But I swear to God, it's like you've got Enki landing on Earth, and you know he whips out his little droid phone with the LCD screen, and he's doing stuff, and it's like, oh my God, it's like, you know, he's got Verizon or something. You know, it's just hilarious the way the Book of Enki is laid out. It's just like totally relatable to 21st century perception, whereas even 15 years ago, no one would be able to reference it. But you know, this day and age, you know, it's just easy to click it into, oh yeah, they're talking about technology. Isn't this funny that this is coming from Sumerian records that are thousands of years old, and it's talking about frickin' LCD screens and files and keyboards, and it's just like, oh my God. It's a pretty amazing little read, and Josh Reeves does a good job. It's called The Book of Enki. It's frickin' hilarious.
Is that a YouTube thing?
Yes.
Oh yeah, you can find it on YouTube. Enki is spelled E-N-K-I. I do believe the full title is The Lost Book of Enki. But if you just type in Book of Enki, Josh Reeves, R-E-E-V-E-S, I do believe, you should be able to find it. It's like a multi-part, like, series. It's incredibly long, because he does a radio show, as far as I know, and, like, each, like, section of reading was, like, one episode of the show, so, like, this happened over a period of time. So it takes about 13 hours in total to get through the whole thing, so probably not going to do it in one sitting, but it is freaking great. I mean, the way he was reading it and his sense of humor, he had me rolling on the floor cracking up, but it's just freaking great. Jay listened to it, too, I do believe, didn't you?
Yes, and didn't he also do that Book of Thor or something like that too? On his radio?
Emerald Tablets of Thoth or something to that effect. He did that as well. There's supposed to be some stuff that Thoth wrote up, and they kind of it basically continues right after the Book of Enki is what it does. Because the Book of Enki is like goes into all the, shall we say, Nibirian screw-ups, if you want to, you know, put it that way, and how originally religions and, you know, the secret societies and stuff were put in place to protect knowledge and slowly reveal it to mankind as mankind matures so that they don't destroy themselves with it. But then this one guy they call Marduk, like, got cocky, and then that's where, you know, you get your whole, like, you know, ancient nuclear wars and stuff. And then the Book of Enki, the Thoth writings kind of take it forward, and they talk about what, you know, David Icke calls the Archons, and they're known as other names, these multidimensional forces that kind of come in and basically, you know, you could tell that they kind of, like,
took over Marduk, just like how these entities take over these elite bloodlines. And that's how that level of corruption started. And then these bloodlines just these infiltrations, they started infiltrating the secret societies, so they kind of had to up their security with, the word magic and the way of phrasing, so that when you read it one way, it reads as one thing, and you read it from another perspective, it reads as another thing. And, there still are, shall we say, people of the light, for lack of a better way of saying it, that are still to the original plan of protecting and releasing the knowledge as we're ready for it. And it's just this big, just the same old pissing match between light and dark, and we're all starting to integrate and come together. But it really adds a lot of perspective to the things that we already know, really, but it adds a lot more detail and things like start to make sense. So it kind of validates your own knowledge. I mean, if you're already into this esoteric stuff, for the people who already have studied and know quite a bit about it, then you'll listen to those two things. And besides getting a major laugh, because Josh Reeves does both of it so well, be like, that makes more sense. And, that makes more sense. That makes more sense. So it's really just an expansion on what we already know. It's a good listen. It's long, but it's really good. Both of them are really good.
So that's nice. If he's interesting, nice to listen to.
It's Stephen Fry. You know, the guy who reads Harry Potter books. He's very nice to listen to when people are reading. Some people have got. They get the pace right, and they get the expression of the...
Josh Reeves is very politically incorrect, so I mean, just to warn you, because, especially, with the Book of Enki, there's, Enki couldn't really keep his lizard in his pants too well, so the book is kind of describing his, escapades. And, you got, Josh Reeves going, damn, Enki is a pimp! And let's just say he gets a bit more expletive with his humor. I'm giving you the light version.
So but he uses the F-bomb, the C-word, the N-word, the L-word, the Q-word.
If it exists, it's probably in there. And if it's politically incorrect and profane, it's probably definitely in there. So it's not everybody's style of humor, but for those who appreciate such things, it is freaking great. It's I have a YouTube channel where I got a thing called Paradigm Shift and Educational Comedy, and Josh gets way more crazy than I get with these things. Wow. So it's for those who have an affinity for the George Carlin-esque sort of humor will really enjoy Josh Reeves. That's my opinion.
Well, it looks like the people in the Wolf Spirit chat room would quite appreciate that level of humor at the moment. It does seem to be... people are not behaving very well here, I have to say. It's very funny. So,
well, that's probably a good thing, though.
We are not supposed to behave. We are built to break rules. That's what, this is what our job is. These people here listening, us people, we are here to be who we are, which means not to behave. never thought I'd hear myself saying that. Especially the father of a teenager, but,
I always like to say that the most easy and effective way to piss absolutely everybody off is just be yourself. Because we live in such a conformist society.
All right. They're just starting to get the stuff about Enkina. So there's these ancient texts that talk about this stuff. Now, here's the thing. When I say, the government, this is the same thing. This is the control system that has been attempted to impose on us all throughout the ages. And, the Roman Empire kind of got a certain place and then it kind of petered out because it didn't have enough support underneath it, so it collapsed. Because you can't support a lie forever. You can only support it, like they say. You can fool some of the people all some of the time. No. You can fool... Yeah, can't fool me. No. You can fool some of the people all of the time, or all the people some of the time, but you can't fool your mother. We have so many so many places today that the cabal is overextended, that they're just, in a way, they're kind of hoping that the whole structure survives, because it's like fake it till you make it. They know that that's a rule. That's a rule of the universe. You fake it till you make it. It's like what Jay's been talking about. Well, I'll bring Jay in a minute to talk about how we can do this with the higher consciousness intention exercises and things like that. But essentially, they know the rules. They know the way the universe works, and they fake it till they make it. So they fake it by scaring lots of people into thinking that they're completely in control. You know, just because they've got a camera on every street corner doesn't mean they've got anything effective to touch anybody on every street corner. You know, they say, oh, well, we've got all these drones, you know. Well, you've only got a certain number of drone pilots, and they have to be highly trained. You know, how many millions of drone pilots have you got? Well, not that many, eh? Do you know what I'm saying? That there really aren't enough resources to control everybody if everybody misbehaved all at the same time.
Yes, that's very, very true. And the worst thing is their own technology is putting them in their prison, so to speak. The thing is, when you try to control another, the problem is, you have to react to whatever they do. And in a way, that person that you're trying to control controls you. Because if they do something, then that causes a reaction in the ones that trying to control. So they're basically being led just as much as the government believes that it's doing the leading, but it ain't, because it's reacting to what the people are doing.
Hey, I just found something for you guys. There is a graphic I did on my Facebook page that was kind of, you know, poking a bit of fun at Josh's humor about some things that was discussed in the Book of Enki. And within the description on that, I also include a link to the playlist that, you know, to where, you know, you can check out the Book of Enki and all I'm talking about with that. So, I'm going to post that in the chat room right now. So I just wanted to, you know, put that out there verbally here that I'm about to be sticking that in the chat room. So anybody wants to see my little humor graphic there and get the link at the same time, so that later on, if they have 13 hours to kill and they want to spend the whole thing laughing and learning at the same time, that information's about to be available for them here. Okay, I'll go back to shutting up now. Take it away, Jay.
Well, you ever notice little kids already know that when a person's trying to control them, they're actually sending energy to them. So if you ever notice, when a parent is trying to control some children, the children seem to get in more fights and stuff, because it draws the parents in, and they actually absorb the energy from the parents. You know, it's a type of vampirism. You know, the thing is, when we become more ourselves and the government tries to control us more, they're going to exhaust themselves, basically, because instead of you giving them power, they're going to be giving you power. It has just
exactly
the opposite effect.
Exactly. If you've got a tube, it can go both ways, can't it?
Right.
And so just before you let go of things, you know, send one down. Just before you cut the cord, so, you know, tie something to the end of it. So that when it retracts, you know, it's got something to chew on at the other end.
So this is basically what's happening, is the people are becoming aware and just deciding to start doing their own thing. And it's causing a disarray in government. So they try to compensate by getting more violent, and the more violent they get, the more disapproval they get, and the people do their own thing more. Because there's more of them to do it, because the people wake up because of the behaviors of the government trying to control. And the more they try to control, the less control they have.
That's right. When the government is harsh, the people get crafty.
Mm-hmm.
As Lao Tzu said 6,000 years ago, you know, haven't they learned by now? I do like the Tao Te Ching. It's one of my favorite books. How are we doing for time? Oh, we're 20 minutes out. If anybody wants to call in, we are available on the Wolf Spirit Radio call-in number. Also, the Freedom Screen. Actually, I don't know if there's a Studio B Freedom Screen or whether it's that. But you can definitely get in through Skype on wolfspirit.switchboard and 1-775-657-5973. Or indeed, let's see, how do I do it? Did I go last week? Yes. Ah, got it. Here we go. Error code 310-421-4053 is the Studio B specialized call-in line. And you can call in straight into this conversation and join us. We're talking about what is going on the weekend, really, which is the beginning of... I think this is definitely a beginning of the turning back. The time when the tide turns. When it suddenly, you know, like you were saying, Jay, earlier, about if you're trying to control people, you're sending energy their way. You're oppressing means that you're pressing. So it takes a lot of energy to do that. And at some point, the source of your energy has to dry up. It's a natural law. And... so when that does happen, then whatever you're trying to push, i.e. if you're trying to hold the ping pong ball down at the bottom of the fish tank, it's your strength will eventually go, and the ping pong ball will naturally rise, and that which naturally would have happened anyway starts to happen anyway, and the whole thing snowballs, and the system of control becomes a thing of the past. That's the theory, isn't it?
Yeah, and you have all these power addicts up there with no fix.
Call in now. 1-900-JOURNEYS. Adult consciousnesses only.
New age porn, though. Yeah,
yeah,
come and have text with an enlightened being.
Yeah, joy porn.
You want to be an enlightened being? Here, I'll stick a flashlight in your ear.
Meanwhile.
Meanwhile, back at the back, Jay.
Is it time? No, maybe we don't. Meanwhile. Yes. Joy's talking about the wolf. Swallowed the grandma whole.
And a hungry like a wolf. Da, 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 da.
So, yes, meanwhile, back at the Wolf Spirit Radio and Revolution Radio, we've got 20 minutes to kind of sum this up and also to ask for people's ideas, you know, in the chat room or anybody who wants to call in. About other ways of being disobedient this weekend. We know we've got the United We Strike. We've been doing this. We were involved for a wee while, and it's been building up for 3 years, 15th of the month, every month. Disobedience. Don't fly, don't comply. Why? And all this business. So,
nobody.
The 12th, the 13th. That's the weekend, and then Monday, and then Tuesday. So it'll be next Tuesday, it'll be the 15th. Beware the Ides of October. What do you think, Dave?
Yeah, I think maybe that I've noticed that, you know, usually when I'm on the radio, it's like nobody wants to pitch any questions, because I think the amount of talking I already do scares them enough. They don't want to encourage me to do more, you know. There's never any questions.
There's that.
It's like, come on, it's hard enough to get Dave to shut up. We don't want to encourage him to keep coming.
See, they only got the 17th until they got to pay their bills, the government, or default, so they're having problems, and this trucker thing may cause what you would call the event a lot sooner.
The biker videos were awesome. The trucks are going to be even more awesome, but has anybody seen the biker videos? Like, you know, like 55 miles of nonstop, you know, motorbiking, you know, between two and four lanes of just motorcycles, on and on forever. That video is awesome. There's tons of it out there. It's like, wow, unprecedented. Nobody seen it?
Yeah. I saw some of the biker videos. Now, wouldn't it be nice if the truckers were to arrive on Friday and the bikers arrive Saturday and, you know, micro light flyers arrive on Sunday and, you know, people just come and show up in whatever means of transport they do. Wouldn't it be nice if the teleporters could come in and the people in the round vehicles who were mind controlled, they suddenly wake up and realize who they're humans and they're flying these UFO triangles and come and land a couple on the Capitol building.
Maybe
me and Jay were joking around about how after trucks it's going to be Cessnas flyovers of DC.
Oh, what you could do if there's any music capable people, you may want to go there and create a block party right out at one of the parks or whatever and give it a real carnival atmosphere. They won't know what to do about it.
Hey, how about set up a block party on every block in DC? I mean, yeah. What would they do, you know?
That's it. I mean, it has to be a loving party atmosphere. I'm sorry, Dave, I spoke over you. It has to be a loving party atmosphere, doesn't it?
Right.
Yeah, there are cops to beat the crap out of everybody.
You gotta make it joyous and fun. You know, it's the new form of play. We're gonna play in that, as we play their realities will collapse underneath them because they're taking everything so seriously. And there's nothing really serious.
That's right. That's gravity. And gravity is just so, six ray age. Gravity is so last year.
My God, the chat room, it's like Little Red Buffy Hood, the Wolf Slayer. It's like, what the hell are you people talking about? Then she cut off his head, and the wolf, Grandma, and Little Red Riding Hood decided to form a non-hierarchical alternative community. What the heck are people smoking, and why aren't they sharing?
Of course, then again, you could make it a national picnic day, and everyone take a picnic basket and go out there and have a good time.
Yeah, maybe a little bit of a lizard roast. Here, leisure, drop the chalupa.
Either
like
that,
chicken, doesn't it?
Yeah. So does rattlesnake. You could buy a box of Dunkin' Donuts and go out and tease the cops.
Yeah, I saw that. That was so funny. Was it the Spanish? Spanish protesters, and they had a little fishing pole, a bit of string, and a donut.
Yeah.
That was so funny. That is the level of humor that you need to work this with. You know, it's just totally humiliating. It's
smells like Monica, tastes like Obama? What?
But it's kind of along the lines of, you know, you got to stand. It's not about the emotion. You have to stand in the truth of what, so that you stand over the lie. You know, the truth is just so self-evident.
it gives the lie the perspective. And the lie is the conflict. And there's unity and harmony and all that.
If you stand in the truth, then make sure you wipe off your feet first before you walk into the White House.
We could have a clothing drive to get Obama some clothes because he's trying to be the emperor with no clothes.
Oh my goodness, Rochelle woke up. And she finally said something. I thought she'd fallen asleep or something.
must be your calming tone, Dave.
Yes, must be. or maybe it was your Sean Connery thing that you've got going on, yes. but not as strong of an introduction.
You are feeling sleepy, my dear. Sleepy.
Well, getting
heavy.
The truckers, like, reminds me of that old trucker song about with the CD and all that, where they're trying to.
I remember it well.
Yeah.
Like we've got ourselves a convoy.
I used to know all of that, you know,
hey, there's Big Ben, you got the copy on me, 10-4, Rog?
You know, all this stuff, I remember, yeah, I used to do all that CD stuff.
Oh, yeah, yeah, so instead of calling me dragon in your own tongue, you call me dragon in someone else's tongue.
Mm-hmm.
For anybody who's seen that movie.
Mm. No.
No?
No, sorry.
What was the name of that movie, the one where Sean Connery plays the talking dragon? What the heck was that freaking...
No.
Oh, what was
not
it?
Not the Never-Ending Story, is it?
No.
That's a different dragon.
No, different dragon.
Oh, well, never mind.
Very different dragon.
Never mind. Somebody will remember it.
Yeah, that was a luck dragon.
A lovely furry dragon who helped.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Stuff the magnet's dragon scrapes across the floor.
Hey. No purple jokes for that.
Oh, hey, that's what we need to do, is to make a trucker song for these people, for these truckers going to Washington D.C.
Oh, you know how you make them honk? That's easy. You put up a sign that says "Honk if you hate Obama." It'll just be blaring nonstop horns.
Although, we have to remember, it's not Obama that's the problem, it's the government itself.
And it's not even the government itself, it's the controlling hand above that we, in our complacency, have given permission for them to bend us over and screw us in the butt.
Well, I think they built us to be screwed and over and screwed, really.
Well, it's a chicken and the egg sort of paradox. We give them permission to do it against our will. It's a little bit of a contradiction, but when you kind of look at it in like a circular meme that self-perpetuates, then you see that even the Illuminatis themselves are caught in their own mind prison. I mean, they were raised from little kids to hate us, and, you know, I mean, if they were born in some other type of life, if they were born as one of us, then they wouldn't have the perspective of an Illuminati, but, you know, it's perpetuated. It's a freaking meme.
And they're probably more abused than anyone else.
Well, that's exactly it. You know, like I say, people share their feelings, and they've been more abused than we can imagine.
Oh, yeah.
What they do on, you know, the abuse that they give out on a large scale is what they've experienced themselves on a small scale. Over and over and over again, unbelievably number of times. So, you know, it's a fine line. You know, there has to be the truth and reconciliation in this, in that we have to not be angry and rip them to shreds in the streets or anything like that, but to just put them out of the way. And just reduce the government to administration, decriminalize everything that's been criminalized, and start selling Marlboro Straights or, you know.
And one thing I've noticed...
Marlboro Blunts?
It's ironic, but when you give yourself full permission to be angry, then you quickly are no longer angry. It's the negative feedback loop that perpetuates, because then we're starting to feel angry about feeling angry, and like with every turn of the circle, the pressure heightens and it gets worse. It's like we feel guilty about feeling guilty and sad about feeling sad. We see our emotions as this external monster that we can't control, that's coming to get us, that we have to fight, but we can't change what we don't own. So when we own our own emotions, then all of a sudden, you know, we can decide, you know, it's as simple as making any other decision, like, oh, look, I'm eating a shit burger. I don't like that. I'm going to go eat some chicken instead. But if we see it as victimizing us, it's like, oh, the shit burger is victimizing me and forcing me to eat it. I can't stop. Oh, woe is me. I'm in such victimization. If we just take ownership of our emotions and know that it's okay to feel angry, it's okay to feel sad, it's okay to feel all these negative emotions. Little kids know that it's okay to feel it. Look how quickly they get through it. They don't cycle in it. They learn as they get older how to abuse themselves and cycle in it. They don't do that normally and naturally. They're mad for a little while. They give themselves permission to feel it. They know it's okay, and so they get over it. And before you know it, they're romping around happy and laughing again. But us, we cycle and we cycle and we cycle and judge ourselves for judging and hate ourselves for hating and all this and that. And misery just becomes our only reality. It's this negative feedback loop. Own your emotions instead of seeing them as something external to you and victimizing you, and you'll just be able to work through this stuff a lot faster. Just my perspective from my own experiences. I'm not trying to tell anyone what to do. I'm really just reiterating what I have personally gone through.
Jay Larson, Dave Kelso, thank you very much for joining me on tonight's Journeys with JP.
Well, thank you.
Those guys on Friday, and well, we'll see what happens next Monday.
Yes, we will.
See you next week. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.